Hi, I'm Brian Neth.
Hi, I'm Nicole Neth.
This is Little Vera Lee.
And we'd love to welcome you to morning worship.
Hi, we're the Jacobsons.
What's your name?
Parker.
I'm AJ.
I'm Sam, and this is Charlotte. And we're so thankful that you're all here today to celebrate her baptism. Mm-hmm.
Welcome to worship. My name's Elizabeth McCauley, lead pastor at Christ United Methodist Church. I'm so happy you have joined us, wherever it is you find yourself. We are celebrating a grand and glorious thing on this day, two baptisms. We have someone joining our church, and we are naming the commitment that some people have made, a great number of people have made, to be part of this church for 50 years and more. So you'll hear those names later on and hear the story of our gratitude for their witness. So it's a grand day. Following this 9 o'clock video worship, we have 10 o'clock worship in the parking lot. So if you want to jump in your car and come on over, we'll be singing some of those hymns from 1970, 50 years ago. And you can stay in your car so you're safe and protected. And we'll be honoring those members and celebrating those baptisms. And then following worship, there is a grand family gathering over at Soldiers Field. There are details there on your screen. We hope that you will join us with your masks and your sense of delight in being able to see each other. So we're delighted you're here. Welcome to worship.
I'm Pastor Nancy Wheeler Hanlon. Would you join with me now in a time of prayer? Let us pray. Holy, holy, holy God, God of power and might, We come before you this morning with thanks and praise. We thank you for calling us together in worship. From babies being baptized, to longtime members, to first-time guests. We give thanks for being united as a church family. Open our hearts, our minds, and souls to your message of love for all people in all creation, to your message of good news. May we seek to be curious about where we are being called to serve you and others. Help us to listen to your voice this morning and every day. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. How many of you have taken a walk at night and looked up at the sky with its beautiful stars and the glow of a round harvest moon? I have. And when I look up at the night sky on a cool fall night, my heart fills with God's love. When my heart is full, I think of all of God's creations and I want to give thanks. I give God thanks for creating a mysterious universe, a world full of wonders to explore, for creating me, for loving me, and guiding me through all of life's journeys. What do you feel when you look up at a night sky? I hope you feel God's great big love. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Hear these words, Psalm 8. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all of the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens, out of the mouths of babies and infants. You have established strength because of your foes. You distilled the enemy and the avenger. When I look to your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place. What is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man who you care for? Yet you have been made a little lower than the heavenly beings, and crowned him with the glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, also the beasts of the field, the birds of the heaven, the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all of the earth.
Good morning. And greetings from a person who has been a member of Christ Church for over 50 years. As we enter into this time of giving, let's all reflect on the many blessings that we have had during our lifetime and our relationship with the church.
Thank you.
Jesus was a storyteller. Jesus knew in the wisdom of his heart that talking at people can shut them right down. Jesus knew that stories invite the listener into participating in the unfolding of what could be. Stories make the distance between us disappear. Stories weave our humanity together, and stories transform. So here in this church, Christ United Methodist Church, we tell the stories of our faith. We learn them and we tell them because those stories invite us to take our humanity and weave into our humanity the very heart and intention of God. So I'm teaching two Bible studies this fall. One is a disciple Bible study that's forming our youth confirmation curriculum. Our youth are reading scripture. They're coming to know the stories of our faith. And the other class I'm teaching is an adult Bible study called Covenant. And the study invites us into how it is God's heart has lived through stories and is unfolding through the stories of our lives. So through opening ourselves to the story of scripture, we're present to the ongoing story of how it is God reaches toward us, inviting us into the living of freedom and compassion and attention to and care for anyone oppressed by unjust systems. So to those stories, we're adding a book that we're reading together this fall. It's a book called Another Way. And the book was chosen in order to provide a ground for us, to hold us during this divisive election season and this fear-clenched time of pandemic living together. So the theme for this week's chapter is that we are called to ask self-awakening questions. We believe that the church exists in part to create a safe place where human beings can join together with other human beings to ask and listen for self-awakening questions. And this world we love, it needs people who are awake. So on this Sunday, I commend to us two stories. They are related. The first is the story of the prodigal son. And this story calls us to waken because it's a story of how abundance can be squandered. It's a story about how forgiveness and welcome are so desperately needed in this world. It's a story about resentments and grumbling, which we know is a reality in our lives. So as you hear this story this morning, I encourage you to listen to it knowing that you and me and all of us, we are all the characters in this story. Like the younger brother, we all mess up. We can be prone to not appreciating what we have. We want what we want, and we want it now, and we demand what we believe is rightfully ours, regardless of the cost to ourselves and our world. Like the older brother, we all are prone to comparing ourselves to others and feeling resentful, and we can become grumbly about not getting what we are sure is our due share. And like the father, we all find ourselves so longing to forgive and to welcome those we love, even after they have disappointed us, maybe even and especially after they have disappointed us. I encourage you too to listen to this story and consider how it applies to this magnificent church, Christ United Methodist Church, or any church you may be a part of. We are celebrating today the lives of people who have been 50 year or more members of this church. And here's the truth of any body of people, we can sometimes be tempted to squander our inheritance. In this case, the over 165 years of powerful ministry done on behalf of the heart of Jesus in the heart of Rochester, Minnesota, we can forget the astounding blessing that we live and that we are called to steward. We can also, as a church, sometimes dig into our fights and hurts and disappointments, which leave us struggling to find a way to forgive. And we can sometimes grumble so much about what we think we don't have that we won't allow ourselves to enter into the party that is God's grace. That party is going on all around us. I ask you to listen with a third set of ears, too. You didn't know you had three sets of ears. As you listen to this story on this Sunday, as we are being led up to a momentous election in our nation, perhaps we might hear this story and consider how, as a nation, we seem to be intent upon squandering the riches of the inheritance that has been given us. We seem, as a nation, to be encouraged to dig into resentments and disagreements about how people should express their conviction that freedom for all is each person's birthright. We do tend to forget who we are, and we, who have been given so much, are being corralled into camps of older brothers more interested in squabbling than in celebrating the welcome and the power of communal care and celebration. In the New Revised Standard Version of this story, the storyteller says that after squandering his inheritance, the younger brother comes to himself. And after coming to himself, after he's remembering who he is and all that he has inherited, the son goes home to repair relationship. This story, this is our story. It is the story of our church. It is the story of our nation. It is the story of Jesus. So, I share with you Eugene Peterson's version, Luke 15, the story of the lost son. There once was a man who had two sons, and the younger said to his father, "Father, I want right now what is coming to me." So the father divided the property between the two sons, and it wasn't long before the younger son packed his bags and went off to a distant country, and there, undisciplined and dissipated, he wasted everything that he had. After he had gone through all of his money, there was a bad famine all throughout that country, and the son began to know hurt. He signed on with a citizen there, who assigned him to his fields to slop the pigs. And the son was so hungry that he would have eaten the corn cobs in the pig slop, but no one would give him even that. So that brought him to his senses. He came to himself. He said, "All of those farmhands working for my father, they sit down to three meals a day, and here I am starving to death. I am going to go back to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against God. I have sinned before you. I don't deserve to be called your son. Take me on as a hired hand.'" And he got right up, and he went home to his father when he was still a long way off. His father saw him, and his heart pounding, he ran out and embraced his son, and he kissed him, and the son started his speech. "Father, I have sinned against God. I have sinned before you. I don't deserve to be called your son ever again." But the father was not listening. He was calling to his servants, "Quick, bring a clean set of clothes and dress him. Put the family ring on his finger. My son is here, given up for dead, and now he is alive. He has been lost, and now he is found. And they began to have a wonderful time. And all this time, the older son was out in the field. And when the day's work was done, he came in. As he approached the house, he heard the music and dancing. And calling over one of the houseboys, he asked, "What is going on here?" And the houseboy told him, your brother came home. Your father has ordered a feast, the fatted calf, because he has come home safe and sound." Well, the older brother stalked off in an angry sulk, and he refused to join in. His father came out and tried to talk to him, but he wouldn't listen, and the son said, "Look how many years I have spent serving you, never giving you one moment of grief, but have you ever thrown a party for me and my friends?" And then this son of yours, who has thrown away your money on dissolute living, shows up, and you go all out with a feast. His father said, "Son, you don't understand. You are with me all the time, and everything I have is yours. But this is a wonderful time, and we had to celebrate. This brother of yours was dead, and he's alive. He was lost, and now he's found." Amen, amen, and amen. It's a story of the humanity we live and the amazing grace we are called to bear witness to. So I mentioned two stories. The second story I commend to our attention on this day is the story of this church. We are celebrating, as I mentioned, on this day, members who have been committed to this church for 50 and more years. For 50 and more years, they have lived and loved and failed and soared and led and prayed, and forevermore, their story is woven into the story of this amazing church. Dee Dee O'Dell is a historian extraordinary. She's a storyteller. And she's going to tell you the story of what was going on here when 50 years ago, these powerful souls joined their story with that of Christ United Methodist Church.
Good morning. I am Dee Dee O'Dell, and I would like to tell you some things about the happenings of 1970. The year 1970 was begun at Christ Church with the Carleton College Choir leading in worship and St. Olaf College having a concert at CUMC. Rochester Boys Choir, under the direction of Harold Cook, led the church in music also. Acolytes were Scott Fieser, Tony Gibbs, and Doug Rothschild, with Sarah King in charge of the program. These were for boys in fourth through seventh grade. The senior high MYF programming included the study of military service and the philosophy of life and history of Jewish people. The David Williams family was home on leave, and many activities were planned during this time. A Come to the Mala, a Pakistani children's fair, was planned by Mrs. Williams for all the children. It cost 25 cents per person, and a good time was had by all. While in the United States, Mrs. Williams received the WSCS Mission Recognition Award. Boy Scout Troop 98 of Elton Hills did a community service project and painted 20 portable dividers and cleaned and varnished 34 tables in Wesley Hall. Remember seeing these dividers around the church? They're more than 50 years old. The confirmation program was for 2 years, with Scott McCallum, Lee Gerrits, and Diane Shopto being confirmed. There were 80 other confirmands. Girl Scout Sunday was celebrated with Lelani Gibbs and Patty Kirkham receiving the God and Community Award. The Chancel Guild made a new Easter banner of Easter lilies to be hung in the back of the balcony. Law Day was celebrated May 1st. It was first established by presidential proclamation in 1958 to be celebrated nationwide. The article in the bulletin said the purpose of Law Day is 1, to foster respect for law and understanding of its essential place in American life. 2, to encourage citizen support of law observance and law enforcement. 3, to advance equality and justice under law. And 4, to point up the contrast between freedom under law in the United States and government tyranny elsewhere. Mr. and Mrs. Sett and a distaff crew organized by Joe Sheldon painted 10 classrooms and the upper east hallway. The God and Country Award was earned by Brian Stoppel, Bill Martin, and Kevin Peterson. The Minnesota Annual Conference was held at St. Olaf College. Elizabeth Souter was ordained an elder. Rochester High School's graduated 85 church members. Familiar names were Clark, Gill, Heil, Morris, Pagenhart, Richter, Stoppel, Wilson, and Barlow. The Wortelman family moved to Windham, and Robert Hunter became the youth pastor. The Tuesday noon recitals were recorded for Sunday afternoon radio broadcasts. Reverend Scoggin was one of the participants. In July, the Williams family returned to Lahore, West Pakistan for 3 more years. There was a Minnesota Conference youth tour of Europe. 35 youth participated. Those from our church were Elizabeth Hepper, Eric Christensen, and Robert Higgins. Reverend Scoggin and Reverend Wagner of Hennepin Avenue United Methodist Church started the children's music camp at Koinonia Methodist Camp. Elna Ludden retired from Mayo Hospital Libraries and became a missionary to the Pakistan United Christian Hospital to start a library there. The Rochester Toastmaster Club offered a leadership training series for high school youth. September began the fall programming year with 810 attending the first Sunday school class. Margo Huber and Greg Blaisdell were among those baptized. Another new banner was hung in the back of the balcony of a tree depicting Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. This was again made by the women of the Chancel Guild. The Christmas Festival Bazaar was held on December 1st. WSCS charged $1.25 for the ham loaf dinner and homemade pie. Another new banner for the balcony was completed by the Chancel Guild for the Christmas season. It was in 4 sections depicting the 4 weeks of Advent. Christmas Anonymous provided for 158 families and 577 children. Rochester police urged caution in the following areas. Never leave your cars unlocked. Do not leave keys or valuables in coat pockets. Do not leave purses unattended. And this was back in 1970. The live nativity scene was again held in the east parking lot for 6 nights prior to Christmas. Carol Ellsworth was the church financial secretary. Reverend Peterson gave the sermon on Christmas Eve. The ministers at the end of the year were Haycock, Peterson, Munson, Scoggin, and Souter. Reverend Munson passed away at the end of December of that year. In Rochester, Mayo Clinic opened the additional 8 floors to the Mayo Building. IBM Rochester celebrated the System 3 and announced an advanced optical character reader. The voting age was lowered to 18 from 21 years. Apollo 13 had an explosion on board and required an emergency return. No one was injured. The first Earth Day was celebrated, as well as the first New York City Marathon. 126 runners began the race. The authors we were reading were Maya Angelou, Pearl Buck, Dr. Seuss, Leon Uris, and Toni Morrison. The books, besides those written by these authors, were Jonathan Livingston Seagull by Richard Bach, and Are You There, God? It's Me, Margaret by Judy Blume. We were listening to the Beatles, even though the group split that year. Jackson 5 and the Partridge Family. Jimi Hendrix and Janis Joplin both passed away at age 27. Hawaii 5-0 was watched on TV, and we saw Patton and Airport at the movies. Broadway musicals were 1776 and Oklahoma. The Academy Awards were held at the Dorothy Chandler Pavilion in Los Angeles. The winners were actor John Wayne for True Grit, actress Maggie Smith for The Prime of Miss Jean Brody, supporting actress Goldie Hawn for Cactus Flower, supporting actor Gig Young for They Shoot Horses, Don't They? Music score for non-musical, Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. Music for a musical, Hello Dolly. And best picture, Midnight Cowboy. What a phenomenal array of movies were out that year. Popular clothing was bell-bottom pants, maxi dresses and ponchos. The miniskirt was still popular though. If you got married in 1970 like we did, you probably received multiple fondue pots. We received four. The United States was still in Vietnam, Cambodia, and Laos. Rioting was still happening on college campuses. Did you notice that some of our books and authors were more reflective? People were looking for a quieter time, a more peaceful time. Our history is the fabric of our lives, each thread woven for a reason. Without our history, it is difficult to discern a future. Thank you.
As we read off the names of those we honor and give thanks for on this day, I invite you to join me in giving thanks. Give thanks for Jesus Christ and the compelling power of his story and the story that unfolds through each of us, everything we do as a congregation, as a people, is in thanksgiving for God's grace. So we name on this day the following who are newly 50-year members: Betty Christensen, Lee Gerrits, Dorothy Gores, Pat Robbie, David Martin, Jan Martin, Scott McCallum, Patty Meyer, Audrey Nelson, Linda Peterson, Marsha Pretzer, and David Stutz. And we also name on this day Angeline Sequist, who passed away in August of this year, also a 50-year member. We remember together that in the midst of every time, and certainly in the midst of this time of pandemic and communal challenge, God is writing story through you and through this communal witnessing body called Christ United Methodist Church. Like the prodigal, we are forever found. Like the prodigal, this is our story. And so as we celebrate on this day the baptism of Vera Lee and Charlotte Louise, we give thanks that they are part of our story too. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
We get to choose. We get to choose the stories we seek to honor with our lives. So may you live aware that God's abundance is provided for you, and you get to be part of the welcome of the world. Give thanks. Know your humanity, and know that God is in it with you. And together we weave the story of a blessed future. Amen.